Okay, so when we started, the speaker this morning, David Steurer, and he's going to tell us about identifiable reports and a whole bunch of things.
Thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me to this workshop. So I will talk about connection between proofs and algorithms, especially in a context of problems that arise in machine learning. And you know, of course, we know that proofs play an important role in analysis of algorithms. However, this talk will be about the role of proofs for the design of algorithms. And I will survey several recent works along these lines with my collaborators, including Sam, Pravesh, Aaron, and Sleel, who are part of the workshop and maybe at some point in the audience. Okay. So the kind of problems I want to talk about are parameter estimation problems. So that's an interesting class of algorithmic problems that come from statistics. And the way these problems go is as follows. So we get independent samples of some from some distribution. And what we know about the distribution is that it belongs to some concrete parameterized family of distributions, for example, Gaussian distributions. And our goal is to, given these samples, to estimate or recover the unknown parameters of the distribution. Just the simplest example is that we get samples from a Gaussian distribution, and our goal is to estimate the mean and the covariance matrix of the Gaussian distribution given the samples. Okay, the kind of parameters that we're interested in are more complicated structures like cluster centers or community memberships or topics of documents, things like that. In these cases, parameter estimation often becomes algorithmically, a challenging algorithmic problem. And that's understanding these kinds of algorithmic challenges will be the focus of this talk. And this parameter estimation captures many kinds of unsupervised learning problems, for example, learning mixtures of Gaussians, independent component analysis, matrix completion, stochastic block models. Just to give you more examples, so the way this captures matrix completion is as follows. So here, for matrix completion, the parameter would be some unknown row rank matrix, and the samples would be random entries of this matrix, and we are trying to recover this unknown low rank matrix. For stochastic block models, the parameter is some community structure on the nodes. And the samples that we get are random edges from a graph that represents this community structure in some way. There are, for all these problems, there are also natural variants that are studied. And sometimes those variants are interesting because they exhibit different algorithmic properties. So sometimes the parameters are not worst case parameters, but are chosen from some prior distribution, and then we want algorithms that do better than for worst case parameters. Sometimes we don't want to estimate all the parameters, or we only want to estimate the parameters approximately, and also in these cases we want to use fewer samples. Another interesting model is where some fraction of the samples are corrupted by some adversary. Okay, and we'll see some of these variants in later in the talk. But for all of these kinds of problems, there are two basic questions that you can ask. Okay. The first basic question that you can ask is identifiability. And that means, given the samples, do they contain enough information about the parameter in order to be able to recover it? So that's an information theoretic question where we disregard any computational efficiency concerns. And the second question is, can we efficiently learn the parameters given the samples? And how are these two questions related? Of course, identifiability is a necessary condition for being able to efficiently learn the parameters. And you can ask, is it also a sufficient condition for being able to efficiently learn the parameters? And of course, the correct answer to this question should be no. It should be possible to imagine estimation problems where, even though there's enough information in the samples, you can recover in principle, the algorithmic task of extracting that information from the samples, is an exponentially hard time. It's an exponentially hard task, requires exponential time. Okay. So that would be the correct answer to this question. But I want to propose that there's a more interesting answer to this question. And the more interesting answer to this question is yes. If you insist that identifiability is proven in a nice way, that the proof of identifiability is nice. So in this case, I want to say that identifiability is indeed sufficient to learn the parameters. Okay, so to make this more concrete, what we'll see in this talk is that efficient learning is possible if the proof of identifiability is captured by a sum of squares. And if there's one thing that you want to take away from this talk, then I suggest it be this message. And of course, after seeing Ryan's talk on Tuesday, you will know that when I say sum of squares here, I don't refer to sum of squares in the way we knew it, but I refer to sum of squares to slightly less talented twin brother of sum of squares, where you don't just restrict the degree of the proofs, but you also restrict the bit complexity of the coefficients that appear in the proof. And for this version of sum of squares, that's efficiently automizable, and it has the property that many useful proof techniques are captured by this notion of nice proofs. Okay. Now, let me point out that a priori the statement that I'm making here could be completely empty. Okay. For example, it could be the case that it never happens that identifiability proofs, for these estimation problems are captured by sum of squares. Okay, so then this would be sort of some empty implication. However, it turns out that the best known estimation problems the best known estimation algorithms for many problems can be reinterpreted in terms of these kinds of identifiability proofs. And we will see some concrete examples of that. So in this sense, there are cases where, interesting cases where the identifiability proofs are indeed captured by sum of squares. But this statement could be empty for another reason. Namely, it could be the case that finding or showing that a proof of identifiability is captured by sum of squares is just an equally hard problem as finding an efficient algorithm for estimating the parameters. Okay, so then this would also be a not so useful implication. This is a very subjective issue. It depends on your preferences. But I will show you some examples where sort of through this connection of identifiability proofs and learning algorithms, we it was possible to obtain new learning algorithms. And for these examples, I'm not aware of any other way to get those kinds of guarantees. So from this point of view, it seems to be useful to a useful perspective on designing learning algorithms to look at these identifiability proofs. One interesting aspect of this connection is also that for many estimation problems, it appears to be the case that the point where the identifiability proofs are captured by sum of squares appears to coincide exactly with the point where efficient learning algorithms are possible. For many natural estimation problems, you don't seem to lose anything by looking at learning algorithms through this perspective, and this also gives a way to prove lower bounds for this kind of parameter, conditional lower bounds for these kind of estimation problems. And another appealing aspect of this connection is that thinking about proofs of identifiability, it's a mathematically clean and structural property of your estimation problem, and so we can think about it without being encumbered by concerns of computational efficiency. Okay, so let's see some examples. So those are the examples we will discuss. Let me first start with matrix completion. So matrix completion is a very well studied problem in machine learning. And the way this goes is that we're given some partial matrix that contains a few entries that we observe from some unknown matrix, and our goal is to fill in the missing entries of this partial matrix. This problem comes up in many settings. Maybe the most prominent setting is these recommender systems, where you have some ratings for movies from users, and your goal is to infer the preferences of the users for all movies. That would be one example of matrix completion. There's a huge body of work on algorithms for matrix completion, both from a theoretical point of view and a practical point of view. And so let me focus on one representative result that it gives the strongest known theoretical guarantees for recovery. And what this shows is that there is an efficient algorithm that can exactly recover some unknown matrix if the the matrix has rank R. And then there's some technical condition that we ignore for now, and the number of entries that you need to observe is roughly R times n, and those should be random entries in the matrix. Okay. And this algorithm is based on a semi-definite program. And what I want to show you now is how to reinterpret this algorithmic result in terms of identifiability proofs and that are captured by some weak proof system, and later. So that will just be some reinterpretation of a known algorithmic result, and then we will see that this perspective allows you to get new algorithms for more general problems. So let's look at this setup. So we have some unknown matrix capital X, and we know it comes from some set script X sub R. Okay, and let's think of it as the set of rank R matrices. And now, this matrix is unknown. We only know it's in this set. And now we observe some of its entries. So we get this partial matrix X sub omega, where omega is the set of entries that we observe from the matrix. And the question is, what we'd like to do is we would want to recover X just given X sub omega. But now I want to talk about what does identifiability mean in this context? Okay. So identifiability means that what we want is that this X sub omega contains enough information about X so that we can uniquely identify this matrix capital X that we know is in the set script X sub R. And so what it means in this context is very simple. Yeah. So what it means is that identifiability is that we look at all matrices in the set where we know X belongs to, and then we look at all matrices that are consistent with our observations, and we know that the correct X lies in the intersection of those two sets, and what we want is that X should be the only point in the intersection of these two sets. Then that is exactly what it means that we can uniquely identify that capital X is uniquely identified by these partial observation X sub omega. Okay. Are there any questions about that?
Yes. What if you relax the unique identification? Like maybe there's some small pre-image?
Oh yes, you can definitely study these things. So here I want to have algorithms that recover the matrix X exactly, and for that goal, sort of that's the right notion of identifiability. And now, what we want is a concise proof that this holds. Okay, and what does it mean? So this is proof in the same notion as proofs in the context of NP and co-NP. What this means is that given X omega and this rank bound R, but we want to have a nice proof that this condition is satisfied, okay. And you notice that this is a non-trivial task because I want to have a proof that imagine that someone gives you some candidate X, okay, and you have this partial matrix X sub omega. And now you want to convince yourself. You want to have a way to convince yourself that there's no other possible completion of X sub omega except the X that you have. Okay. The naive way to do this would be to try out all matrices that agree with the observations. Even though it's an infinite large set, so let's entertain that thought. We try out all these matrices and check that all of them, besides X, have rank different from R. Right, that's what it means that this intersection is exactly the point of the matrix X. Okay. And of course, trying out all these possibilities is a very big proof. And what we want is a concise proof of that, okay? A proof that we can check efficiently. So let me tell you, how this proof could look like. But before, I want to make the setup a bit more concrete. So instead of looking at rank R matrices, let me look at rank R projectors. Okay, so that just makes some notation simpler, but it doesn't really change anything. And now I want to claim that a kind of concise proof of this fact, given X, omega, and R, consists of one example of such a proof would be a polynomial P that satisfies the following two conditions. Okay, what we want from the polynomial P is the first condition is that P should be a linear combination of those monomials, ui times uj, where ij is one of the entries that we observed, one of the elements in omega. And the other condition from P is that P of u should always be bounded by the norm of u squared, Euclidean norm of u squared. And furthermore, we want that equality holds if and only if u is in the span of a1 up to ar. Where A1 up to AR is the correct, is the orthogonal decomposition, is an orthogonal decomposition of the correct matrix X. Okay, so these are, let me just say this. So given X omega omega and R, you can efficiently check and such a polynomial P, you can efficiently check whether these conditions are satisfied. Right, you can compute these A's, and you can compute that you can check that P is indeed a linear combination of these monomials. So all the other monomials have to have coefficient zero, and you can also check this condition that it's a little bit tricky to maybe or requires a short thought. So this condition, what it says is that if you think about so P here is some homogeneous quadratic polynomial. If you look at the quadratic, so that means that P is the quadratic form of some matrix. And this condition, the second condition, just means that the top eigenspace of this matrix should be exactly the span of A1 up to AR. Okay. So those are, if I give you X and omega and this polynomial P, then you can check that these conditions are satisfied efficiently. And what I claim is that if you have such a polynomial like that, then indeed this this identifiability star holds. Okay, so that's a way to that's a concise way to prove that there are no other completions of the matrix X sub omega. Okay, that the completion of X sub omega is unique among all rank R projectors. Okay, and maybe I should say one thing. This sort of looks like that. It falls from like magically appears these kind of conditions. But I will not go into this. But you can sort of see that basically these here you're interested in these two sets and you want that they intersect uniquely. And basically these two conditions, they the first condition is about this set, something about the normal cones of this set. And the second condition is something about the normal cones of the other set. Okay. And so there's some generic way of sort of if you have any two sets convex any two sets there's some way to get some condition like that that implies this unique intersection. Okay. Good. So now I want to show that indeed a polynomial like that implies that star holds. And it's just a very, very simple proof. So let's look at why some arbitrary matrix that has this kind of a decomposition. And now, suppose that if y agrees with our observations, what you can check is that so the following thing holds. If you sum up the values of the polynomial p at the points b sub k, then that's the same as if you would sum up the values of the polynomial p at the points a sub k. Okay, and why is that? So by linearity, it's enough to check that this holds for a monomial ui times uj. So here we only use the first property of p. So it's enough to check that this holds if p is just a monomial ui times uj, where ij is an observed entry. And then, you know, you see that if you sum up these values, and P is just a monomial U I times U j, then you know, if you sum up these values, what you get is exactly the ij entry of y. And what you get here is exactly the ij entry of x. Okay, but our assumption was that, you know, because ij is an observed entry, and our assumption was that y agrees with x on the observed entries. Okay. And notice that, you know, because of the second property, we actually know that this sum here is equal to r. Right, because so the AIs are off normal vectors, so all of them have unit norm, so each of these summons is 1, so the total sum is r. Okay. Now, if you now use, now, you know, here we make the assumption that y agrees with the observations. Now, if we also make the assumption that y is in the set x sub r, y is a projector of rank r, then, you know, you can use the second property of the polynomial p to show that, and this what we concluded before, that, you know, that this sum is equal to r, to conclude that y is equal to x. Okay, why is that? Well, you know, by the second property of p. So first of all, you can make you can assume that the BEKs case are off normal, because y is in this set. And then by the second property of the polynomial p, you know, each of these summons is at most 1. Okay, now we have these r numbers that sum up to r. Okay, but all of the numbers are at most 1. So the only way that you can have equality here is if you know, each term here is equal to 1. But if it's equal to 1, then, you know, by this property of p, actually bk has to be in the span of the ais. Okay, so it means that now you know that each bk is in the span of the ais, and you know that the bks are orthonormal. Okay, so that just means that the bks are an orthonormal basis of the span of the ais. And then, you know, so that means that y is the projector into that span, but x was also the projector into that span, so y is equal to x. So, and what you should sort of, okay, so let's go further. So, so we have now, we saw now that there's this notion of identifiability proof, and if you have a polynomial like that, then you know that this completion is unique. And now, you know, let me maybe go back. Now our goal is to get an algorithm from this, okay? And a priori, you know, this seems, you know, completely useless for our goal of getting an algorithm, right? Because sort of this is useful for the much easier task where I give you some candidate completion and I just ask you, you know, is that the correct completion or is it the only completion? This seems to be, you know, so that you know, your ability to do that is so basically you can check whether your answer is good, but your ability to do that, you know, seems to be completely useless for the goal of finding such a completion. Okay, and you know, on some level, you know, we're sort of proving that this problem is an NP on some level. Okay, so that's the question is now, how can you make this into an, you know, how could this possibly be useful for getting an algorithm? And the idea here is that you know, actually this identifiability proof is captured by a weak proof system in a certain sense, and that's and sort of that weakness of the proof is what gives us the power to get an efficient algorithm from it. And now, what you know, in what sense is this proof weak? So that giveaway, if you sort of go back, look at this proof and look at sort of what we did about this proof. So that two dead giveaways that this is a weak proof. You know, one is that we can efficiently check it. So that's that's a good property of this proof. Another you know, when say sense in which you know, this proof is weak is if you look at these kind of things. You know, these are all equalities. Okay, and that's sort of you know, simple kind of proofs that all the equalities. Another thing is that which is. Another property here is that, like, this kind of thing is linear in P, so that like all these equations are linear in P. It turns out to be a useful property. But so there, you know, it's sort of clear that this is not a terribly you know, complicated proof, and that's what will be useful. So the way we the kind of algorithm that we will derive, you know, like all proper algorithms, will be based on a convex relaxation. You know, and if you're willing to do convex relaxations, then what it means is that, you know, instead of trying to find a solution, you're really trying to find a distribution over solutions. Okay. And now, you know, here's how the algorithm looks like. So what we want to do is we want to find a distribution D over matrices in the set X sub R, so over these rank R projectors. And what we want from this distribution is that the expected matrix under the distribution, if you look at the entries in omega, that should agree with our observations. Okay. So notice that this algorithm just gets this, you know, these observations x sub omega, this partial matrix x sub omega, and tries to recover x. You know, okay, so we compute a distribution that satisfies this property. I will tell you in a second how, you know, why you can do that efficiently. But let's just take this as a given. And then the what the algorithm does after that is just that, you know, it outputs the expected matrix y under that distribution. Okay, so that's how the algorithm works. And now let's see why this algorithm. So let's, you know, ignore for a second this. You know, why you can implement this algorithm efficiently. But let's see in what sense this algorithm works. And what I want to claim is that if there exists a nice identifiability proof P for x and omega, then the algorithm will find, then this algorithm will find that x. Okay. And here's the proof sketch. And essentially, you know, it uses the fact that we only use very little properties. When we verified that at this polynomial, the existence of this polynomial P implies the uniqueness of the completion, we only use very little properties about these potential other completions Y. Okay. And in particular, what you can get is that, you know, if the expectation of expected matrix agrees with x on omega, then if you now sort of look at the expected sum of these evaluations of the polynomial p, where now b sub k is is a random vector that you get by decomposing y under the distribution. So you have this distribution over the y's, and for every y, I can decompose it into these orthonormal vectors b sub k. Right, because every y in the distribution is comes from this set, and what I claim is that the expectation of this sum is equal to r. Okay, and the reason why before what we saw is that if y sub omega is equal to x sub omega, then this sum is equal to this sum is equal to this sum, and the thing is that this also holds just if the expectation of y agrees with x on omega. Okay. And this has to do with the fact that, that these are linear equations in P.
Okay.
And basically now you're done, because let's ignore sort of how you got this. But if you have this, then you're done, because now you still have now you have this expectation over these numbers is equal to r. It's still true that each of these numbers is at most one. Because the bk's are unit vectors, and that means that the only way that that this can be r is that each of these summons has to be one, but as we, just the same argument as we saw before, that has to mean that the bk's span the same on orthonormal basis for the span of the ai's, and actually sort of this really means that this distribution d over this distribution here is concentrated on a single matrix in X sub R, and that single matrix is the correct completion of X sub omega. We also notice that this is not a convex set, this X sub R. So in general, right, if you do this expectation of Y sub omega, it will certainly not be in X sub R, but if you have a if you have this, such a polynomial P exists, then that will be the case.
Okay.
So this shows that the algorithm works if there exists this identifiability proof P. And now the other claim is that you can actually implement this algorithm in polynomial time. And I will not sort of show this in detail, but the reason is that if you look at the convex hull of these rank R projectors, this set has a polynomial time separation oracle. And that means that, and that's actually enough to implement this. We saw that if you have we saw this algorithm that has a property that if a polynomial P like that exists, then the algorithm outputs the correct answer. Now, a priori this is not useful, because we now have to show that these identifiability proofs exist, And this is true. In the following sense, so if omega is a random set of large enough, and x satisfies this technical property of incoherence, then such an identifiability proof exists with high probability. So this will very briefly sketch how this goes. Actually, this proof is mysterious. So the reason why I'm sketching it is because this proof is mysterious to me. I would love to have to know a better proof of that. This is a construction due to Cross and Recht, an iterative construction of this polynomial P. What you do is you start with some polynomial P0 that obviously satisfies this property of P. Okay, so this polynomial obviously satisfies sort of a canonical polynomial that satisfies this property. And now, it might violate this property. So what you do is you just project in the Euclidean sense to all polynomials that satisfy this property. So that's a linear subspace. And then after you do this projection, you might violate this property. So now you project to the affine span of the polynomials that satisfy this property. And now you keep going. Yes?
Does this procedure obviously preserve the bit complexity of the, like, you needed a small bit complexity SOS proof, right?
That's a good question. So in this context, not. Because so in this context, you are in a situation where if you have if you have any proof, then you can also have a small bit complexity proof.
Okay.
But I think you could analyze this construction and also show that the construction has preserved small bit complexity. Number of iterations that you need is sort of logarithmic, and each of them is these kind of projections.
Well, you're not going to get an exact solution this way, right?
No, P will satisfy this property. That's true. So there are some cleanup step in the very end, which I'm skipping. That's true.
But, I mean, this is like a proof of showing that something is feasible by showing that the dual isn't feasible, kind of, like, I think.
If you think about convex programming relaxations, then you can interpret this P as a dual solution. And now you show that there existed this dual solution. But this, this construction is somewhat, somewhat strange. I mean, I'm not sure how to interpret it.
Okay.
And I don't know a canonical interpretation of this.
It seems like you could either come up with a relaxation and then look at the dual and what it says, or you could try to come with a proof. And
yes.
Would it be easier to come with a relaxation than to come with a proof?
That's a good question. Right. So there's this general. I mean, so all these kinds of any kind of identifiability proof you can also interpret as a dual solution for a convex relaxation to your problem. And these are valid, you can either have the viewpoint that I first think about the convex relaxation and then understand the dual, or I first think about identifiability proofs and then think about the corresponding convex relaxation. The proposal in this talk is that the second is sometimes useful. Or maybe often is.
Okay.
Good. So that sort of concludes this reinterpretation of this matrix completion algorithm in terms of identifiability proofs. And now I want to show you how to use this perspective in order to get an algorithm or to get an analysis for a more general problem called tensor completion, where instead of having a partial matrix, you have a partial tensor, partial three tensor, let's say, and you still try to fill in the missing entries. And this comes up the same way as matrix completion comes up in many settings. You could try to solve this problem by reducing it to matrix completion, because a three an n by n three tensor. So three tensors just means an array where you have three indices as opposed to two indices for matrices. An n by n three tensor. You can also think of it as an n by n squared matrix. If the three tensor has rank r, then that matrix has rank r, at most r. And So that would give a reduction from tensor completion to matrix completion. However, it turns out that if you do that reduction, the number of entries that you need to sample is r times n squared. Okay. And what we show is a result where you only need to sample r times n to the 1.5 entries in order to be able to exactly recover some unknown rank r 3 tensor, assuming some incoherence conditions. And this improves over some previous works that we're able to recover this tensor only approximately. So one important thing that I want to point out is that there's a gap between what you can do information theoretically and what you can do efficiently, in the sense that from information theoretically, you need r times n random entries, still, just like for n by n matrix, but it appears to be that at that point, if you have only that number of entries, there are no nice identifiability proofs.
For what range of ranks?
I didn't write this. So this is for the case where R is at most n. Actually, I want that this is an orthogonal 3 tensor.
That's good.
Yes.
In
the previous. Just for matrix completion, did you show us what the randomness is sort of helping us with?
So the randomness is only helping in showing that there exists this polynomial P. So you use that to analyze this alternating projection procedure. That's the only place where the randomness comes in. The existence of the polynomial P, if you have a polynomial P that satisfies these properties that I showed you, you don't need any further properties of the matrix or the entries that you observed. So just the existence.
Can one say sort of up front what one wants from the randomness, or is it something that you need to analyze step by step?
So that's a good question. So I think depending on how tight, what kind of bounds you want, if you know that the matrix, the graph that corresponds to the entries that you observed is a very good expander, then that gives you some bounds for how many edges you need the expander to have in order to be able to complete. But I think it doesn't it doesn't have this r times n dependence. I think it might have r squared or r cubed dependencies.
And it's rn if you don't want exact recovery, but if you want exact recovery and
rn is actually I think if you want just an r dependence, I'm not sure if you can do that. I think you can shave off the log n. So there's some log n factor which I omitted in the tilde notation, which you can shave off if you do this expander business. But I'm not sure if you get the right r dependence.
Okay. Right.
And now we want to do tensor completion. And the nice thing is that certain things just look like before. So we can think of we have a tensor that is inside this set, rank R tensors where the AIs are orthonormal. And now the natural extension of this polynomial P that we had before is now, P should be now a linear combination of these monomials, degree 3 monomials, corresponding to the entries that we observed. And what we want is that the unique maximizers over the sphere of this polynomial P should be the polynomials A1 up to AR. Okay, so those are the two properties that we want from this polynomial. And it turns out that if you have a polynomial like that with these two properties, then indeed you have identifiability. Okay. However, unfortunately, this does not count as a nice proof of identifiability. So I said candidate. So why is that? The reason is that, for example, this second condition, is an NP-hard condition to Jack in general, because optimizing a degree 3 polynomial over the sphere is an NP-hard problem. So in that sense, you can't even check that this property that these properties are satisfied. So usually you want proofs to be checkable, and also if you try to use the same algorithm, the kind of issue that you run into if you now look at the convex hull of X sub R, for matrices, this had an efficient separation oracle, but now it is NP-hard to separate over. Okay, so now it looks like that sort of this failed, but now I want to tell you that there's a systematic way to fix all of this, and the way to do that is that instead of requiring, instead of just saying that, this property is satisfied, we want that this property also has a, you know, has a good proof, in the sense of having a low degree sum of squares proof. And once you do that, the way you can fix the algorithm is that instead of asking for a distribution over for an actual distribution over this set X sub R, you just ask for a pseudo distribution over this set X sub R, and this, you know, the pseudo distribution is just the dual notion of sum of squares, you know, that corresponds to sum of squares proofs. So these pseudo moments that you might use. And that's basically the only changes that you need to do to make this all go through. Sort of one magical thing that happens is that if you can construct this this polynomial P in a very similar way to the way, or you can show that these polynomials P exist in a very similar way to how you did it for matrix completion by this alternating projection kind of procedure. And then sort of as an additional step, you somehow have to show that this procedure, you know, ensures this existence of a low degree sum of squares proof. But at least sort of all the steps that you need to take, become very canonical. Okay. So now let me show you a different example called dictionary learning. So it's another estimation problem. So the way this problem goes is that what you observe are vectors x1 up to xn, so sampled from some independently from some distribution over n-dimensional vectors, and the way the distribution looks like is that the xi's, each xi is a sparse random linear combination of some fixed collection of vectors a1 up to an, and your goal is to recover these vectors a1 up to an. Okay. So the samples that you see are sparse linear combinations of these vectors a1 up to an. You don't know the vectors a1 up to an. You just see these sparse linear combinations. And your goal is to recover the vectors a1 up to an. This arises in many contexts. In particular, sort of, somehow people think that if you look at natural images, then you can, you know, if you think of these x1 up to xm as images that appear in nature, then if you try to do this, if you try to find these kind of sparse dictionary vectors, these dictionary vectors a1 up to an, it gives you a nice basis for images that allows you to do certain image processing tasks in a good way, and it's also like just It's sort of some well-studied parameter estimation problem, and sort of getting good algorithms for this is some form of benchmark. Okay. And so what you can show here using this connection between identifiability proofs and algorithms is that if you get a polynomial number of samples from this kind of distribution, and you assume that these sparse combinations come from some reasonably nice distribution, then you can efficiently recover these vectors a1 up to an up to some small error. So I won't give you the definition of this epsilon nice, just to give you some sense of sort of what are we will see sort of the, what we will see later on what how this comes in. Just to give you some sense of what are examples of sparse of the distributions of sparse vectors? Why, and then what kind of tasks? What it entails for the algorithmic task? So, for example, if y is just a random one sparse vector, okay, so then this is a trivial problem because then every sample that you see will be one of the columns of AI. So, just if you see enough samples, you will see all of the columns of see all of these vectors a1 up to an, the columns of this matrix A. Now, one case that is information theoretically impossible is if y is a Gaussian vector, a random standard Gaussian vector, and the reason is that for some rotational invariance, rotational invariance, these samples really don't tell you anything about the columns of A. Okay, they only tell you something about uh, what's the subspace spanned by those vectors.
Okay.
And so, in this case, you know, you can have as many samples as you want, but you won't be able to recover the columns of A1 of this matrix A. In one case where there is an algorithm, but it's a sort of a known algorithm, there's an algorithm that has been known for a long time, is if y is of the form where each coordinate is independent, where the coordinates are independent, and each coordinate has a non-Gaussian distribution. Where this is sort of quantified by some kurtosis condition, and if in this case you can actually recover these columns of A exactly. One way to do this is using some kind of tensor decomposition. But what I want to talk about is this case where you don't have this independence, on some level, this epsilon is saying that you have almost so you're close to independent, but not really independent. The proof of identifiability in this case has the following form. What you can show is that if you look at this polynomial p, so this is actually some polynomial that you can compute from the samples, explicitly compute from the samples. It's a degree 4 polynomial. If you look at this polynomial over the sphere, then what you can show is that under this epsilon nice assumption about y, is that the global maximizers of this polynomial over the sphere are close to the vectors a1 up to an that you're looking for. Okay, so now this, if you just ignore everything that I say, you want these vectors a1 up to an, and this polynomial and the global maximizers of this polynomial are close to those vectors, so it means that that you are in this identifiable situation, because an inefficient algorithm could just do an epsilon net over the sphere and enumerate all those vectors and check which ones are the global maximizers of this polynomial, and this property promises you that those vectors that you find in this way are close to the vectors that you wanted to estimate. And the issue is, that's fine, but it's just, it's not an efficient algorithm a priori.
Okay.
It require exponential time. Now, to make it into an efficient algorithm, the key property is that this statement about the polynomial p that you construct in this way, not only does it hold, but it also, but there's also some a low degree sum of squares proof of this fact. Okay. And I wanted to show you briefly how this proof looks like. So what it boils down to is you want to give a low degree sum of squares proof of this kind of inequality. So why is that? Well, this here is the polynomial p that you can estimate, that you can get from the samples, and the polynomial here is a polynomial. Let's say if the vectors a1 up to n are orthogonal to each other, orthonormal, and this polynomial has the property that globally it's maximized by the vectors a1 up to an.
Okay.
And here, so u is a variable of your polynomial, and you think of u as being a vector on the sphere. And so you want to prove an inequality. So if you show given some squares proof of this kind of inequality, so that's the sense in which you can show that the global maximizers of this polynomial are close to a1 up to an. Now, how do you show this inequality? So if you expand this. This polynomial that you have here, then you get different terms depending on y. So one term that you get is of this form, where you have yi to the 4 and then the inner product of ai and u to the 4. And here, this epsilon niceness assumption says that this is 1, the expectation of yi to the 4 for every I. Then another term that you get is sort of these kind of terms, these kind of mixed terms, where you have yi squared, yj squared, and then these inner products of, there's a typo here. This should be aj, not ai.
Okay.
So what epsilon niceness means is that we assume that this here is at most epsilon.
Okay.
And then there are some other terms, and here epsilon niceness means that all these other terms vanish. Okay, so all these other terms mean, they are not squares in y. Okay, and so the assumption about this epsilon niceness means that those go away. Now you're sort of done, because you know, this guy here was exactly, I mean, this guy was your target. You wanted to show that this polynomial is close to this polynomial. So now, you know, you only have to show that this polynomial is small. But by orthonormality, you know that, you know, the sum of these guys over all I is at most this, the, you know, let's say if U is on the sphere, is at most 1 or is equal to 1. And yeah, I apologize. So this here should be really AJ, so that might be confusing. And so that means that this whole thing here, you can upper bound on the sphere by epsilon. Okay, and that's exactly what we wanted. Okay, now. Okay, so the point I wanted to make here is that, you know, this proof it looks like a complete is a complete triviality. Okay, just some very simple manipulation, but it turns out that, you know, even this very simple sum of squares proof is surprisingly difficult to capture without sum of squares. So in the case where you really have orthogonal vectors, you know, we there is a sort of iterative quite involved spectral algorithm with Slil for this case. But even, you know, but this proof sort of works in greater generality. You don't really need that these vectors are orthonormal. You just need sort of some bound on, you know, even if this here is 100 times the norm of U, this proof sort of still works. But in this case, we know how to make the spectral algorithm work. So in that sense, you know, even these super simple sum of squares proofs can be hard to implement with any other algorithm. And the reason is that, you know, because we cheated here, right? Because somehow, you know, this proof used the fact that to show this proof, we could pretend that we know the vectors a1 up to an, okay? Which is, of course, not something that your algorithm can pretend. Okay? Because we here, we really expanded this polynomial in the basis that corresponds to a1 up to an, which is exactly what we wanted to, you know, compute as an algorithm. But because we're just doing here some kind of identifiability proof, this you know, we can pretend that we know the AIs here. And this is what I think the key difference between trying to do this without these identifiability proofs. Right, and now sort of, okay, so after that you have this, so you're sort of done. What you can say is that now if you have these dual objects to sum of squares proofs, you can interpret this as some kind of distribution. And this property says that if you have a distribution that maximizes P of U, which is a pseudo distribution that maximizes the expectation of P of U, which is something that you can, you know, compute efficiently, then what it also satisfies is this property, which is not something that you know, you could enforce because you don't know the AIs. But then you can show that if you have some pseudo distribution that satisfies this property, you can generically recover the vectors a1 up to an.
David?
Yes.
In the same degree, or you need higher?
If the degree, so you mean? Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know. It might be that we need higher degree than 4. It's with some constant degree. Yes.
Can this get in a super resolution? Because you want to recover, if you take, you talk about the SOS side, but if you take the primer, would be to recover measure from moments. So, like, that's right.
Yes.
But usually, for recovering, like that recovery, you need separation of the atoms. Some of the should be so sufficiently separated to recover exactly that, right?
Yes. So here, so this. This is some variant of some classical problem. The difference is that here actually we make very strong assumptions. Maybe I should point here. Here we make very strong assumptions about the AIs. Here, just for this example, I assume that the AIs are orthonormal. So that's a strong assumption. But what makes this harder than the usual kind of setups is that we don't know that that yi and yj, sort of that the coordinates of y are independent. And this is what the key difference that makes this problem harder than so usually these classical algorithms they make this assumption that the coordinates are independent, and then you know, you can on some level there's some algebraic operation that just gives you this object. I'd be happy to talk about this offline. Okay, so now the last thing I wanted to talk about very briefly is community detection. So this will be have a slightly different flavor. Sum of squares will come in a very non-obvious way. And let's do this. So here's here's a stochastic block model described as a parameter estimation problem, where I made it a bit more concise, so I don't talk about graphs here, but I talk about random matrices. So the way this goes is that we choose a random vector y that has plus one, minus one coordinates, just uniformly at random, and then we choose a matrix x in such a way that xij is slightly correlated with yi times yj. Okay, and you know the way this correlation looks like is not so important. So it's some Bernoulli that has expectation, whatever, 1 plus epsilon times y times yj times d over n. Okay, and now if you can think of this as a graph, as a adjacency matrix of a graph, and the average degree of that graph will be d. Okay. And your goal, given this noisy version of y times y transpose, given this matrix, you want to find a vector y hat that is correlated with y. So you don't know y, you just know this matrix capital X, and your goal is to find something that is correlated to y. And what's nice about this problem is that that you can understand very precisely when this problem becomes, when you can do this estimation and whatnot. In particular, there's results by Mosel, Niemann, and Sly and Masoyer that show that if d is any number less than 1 over epsilon squared, so epsilon is sort of how much you are correlated with yi times yj, if d is any number less than 1 over epsilon squared, then it's information theoretically impossible to recover anything correlated with y. And on the other hand, if d is any number bigger than 1 over epsilon squared, then there is an efficient algorithm that can recover some vector correlated with y. Okay. And it turns out that the kind of algorithmic techniques that go into this second result are quite sort of far from convex optimization, convex relaxations. They're inspired by belief propagation, and the kind of algorithms that are analyzed, they use non-backtracking random box. Sort of the motivation for coming up with these algorithms comes from statistical physics. What I want to talk about is some alternative viewpoint on these phenomena in terms of low-degree polynomials. And so that's the part in which, that's the sense in which this viewpoint is somewhat square-ish. And what's an advantage of this viewpoint is, sort of similar to some of squares, what I talked about before, is that, this easily extends to more general problems where it's not clear how to do it with just these techniques. And it also gives some perspective on how to prove, what are good ways of proving lower bounds for these kinds of problems, conditional lower bounds. Let me show you how this goes. So let me tell you about identifiability. So this is the question, what I want to understand is, when does there exist, when is it possible, information theoretically possible, to find, given x, to find some vector y hat correlated with y. Okay, and a priori this is not clear, but I want to show you that there's a very simple criterion, and what you're supposed to do is you look at this function. So it's a function of x, and it outputs a matrix, and the function is just so the matrix capital Y of x is the what you do is you you look at you condition the you look at the distribution of y conditioned on your observations x. Right here, you first sample y and then sample x. But you can also look at this distribution where you condition on x and look at now the posterior distribution of y. And what I want to do is I want to look at the second moment of this posterior distribution of y, okay, given x. And the claim is that you are identifiable. So this. For a particular epsilon and delta, epsilon and d, if and only if the two norm of this function y, with respect to the distribution that you observe, is at least something, and this here sort of the n squared is as large as this could possibly be, right? Y is a plus one minus one vector, so the maximum Frobenius norm here would be the maximum squared Frobenius norm would be n squared. And so they say that you are within a constant factor of the largest possible two norm that you could have. The claim is that you're identifiable if and only if you have this property. And the proof is very simple, basically just some Cauchy-Schwarz. Maybe let me show you the beginning. So let's assume that you are identifiable. So that would be one direction of this theorem, of this claim. So then you have some function y hat of capital X, and the property of this function is that it's correlated with y, and the right notion of correlation would be something like that, and that you square the inner product, and now you get some analytic condition on this function y hat of X, and you can translate that to using Cauchy-Schwarz, you get the desired conclusion. Some simple calculation. And now, just to wrap this up, what this also says is that if you could compute this function y of x, then you could solve this estimation problem. Okay, but it turns out to be hard to compute in general. It turns out that a way to resolve this computational, so this fact that this might be a priori hard to compute is that you just look at the, you think of this as a function in X, and you look at the low degree truncation of this function. Okay, so you just, there are some, you can think of this, you can write this function Y as a low degree polynomial plus a high degree polynomial. Okay, and you just throw away the high degree polynomial, and then now you have the some low degree truncation that, that is close to Y of X, or that, could be close to Y of X, and it turns out that this low degree truncation of y still satisfies this property, and that is enough to, it turns out to be enough to still solve this estimation task. Okay. And so what is used here is that if you have a low degree polynomial, you can always evaluate efficiently. So that's a nice fact of low degree polynomials. Like you can't have this computational hardness. So here, this function is hard to evaluate, but if you have a low degree polynomial, it would be easy to evaluate. Okay. Now to wrap up, so what we saw is that there's a way to turn a priori inefficient identifiability proofs to efficient learning algorithms, and what allowed us to do this is sort of this lens of sum of squares and low degree polynomials. Thank you.
So
what is the degree in the block?
Good question, yes. I'm hiding that, yes. So it turns out the degree is logarithmic, and that's necessary. And now if you have a logarithmic degree polynomial in n variables, a priori you need quasi-polynomial time to evaluate this. But it turns out that, there are certain families of polynomials where you don't need, that have degree d, but you don't need time n to the d to evaluate, but you only need time 2 to the d times poly n to evaluate it. And luckily, this low degree truncation of y belongs to that family.
So why truncations exactly? I mean, good other approximations with low degree, perhaps.
Okay, by low degree truncation, I sort of mean the right approximation by a low degree polynomial in the setting, but it will be very similar to what you suspect it to be, because this is really like some linear algebra setting that we, you want something to be correlated with something else in sort of the Euclidean sense, the way you truncate is really, you look at an inner product, you do it according to an inner product, the natural inner product that you have here, where, it comes from the distribution. Yes.
Good. Any other questions or comments? Good. Let's thank David again.